American Experience is made possible by the Alfred P. Sloan Foundation to enhance public understanding of the role of technology. The foundation also seeks to portray the lives of the men and women engaged in scientific and technological pursuit.
At Liberty Mutual Insurance, we do everything we can to help prevent accidents and make America a safer place. Liberty Mutual is proud to support American Experience.
How do you get a weed-free lawn? A healthy garden, a home that's pest-free. Every day we work to find new and better solutions. Ortho, proud to support the American Experience on PBS.
American Experience is also made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
United States votes $400 million to help that war, we're not voting for a giveaway program. We're voting for the cheapest way that we can prevent the occurrence of something that would be of the most terrible significance to the United States of America, our security.
If we withdrew from Vietnam, the communists would control Vietnam. Pretty soon, Thailand, Cambodia, Laos, Malaya would go.
If this little nation goes down the drain and can't maintain her independence, ask yourself what's going to happen to all the other little nations.
If the United States now were to throw in the towel and come home, and the communists took over South Vietnam, then all over Southeast Asia, all over the Pacific, in the Mideast, in Europe, in the world, the United States would suffer a blow. And peace, because we are the great peacekeeping nation in the world today because of our power, would suffer a blow from which it might not recover.
First a handful of advisors, then the Marines. Finally, an army of 500,000. That was the Vietnam War. It was an undeclared war. A war without front lines or clear objectives. A war against an elusive enemy. A war.
Speak to me.
What's
your name? Tell me what your name is. Where are you from?
Seattle, Washington.
Seattle, Washington. It's a good town. Good town.
Very good town.
No, don't go to sleep.
We had some precarious situations and we lost some people, but we always won. So to me, we were very successful, you know, but as I think of it now, I don't know what we won. We won a box on a map where the next day we left it and we never came back, maybe.
It was a war that blurred the line between friend and enemy.
Wherever the Americans went, they burned and destroyed and killed. I didn't see any guerrillas being killed, only villagers.
An 8-year-old or a 9-year-old can kill you just as quick as a 25 or a 26-year-old man. Back here in the States, the kids are playing cowboys and Indians. Over there, they've been playing it for real.
It was a war with deep roots, deeper than most Americans knew. Ho Chi Minh and his followers fought for decades against the French, then against the Americans and their South Vietnamese ally.
I always believed in my country.
But instead of sending my sons out to defend their country, I sent them out to die.
It was a war that turned South Vietnam inside out. A war that changed the GIs who fought it.
GI, you want Vietnamese cigarette? For a box of Tide, you could get a carton of pre-packed, pre-rolled marijuana cigarettes soaked in opium. For $10, you could get a vial of pure heroin. You could get liquid opium, speed, acid, anything you wanted.
It was the first television war.
What's he got, small arms? Small arms, automatic fire, grenade launcher, and air grenade.
With uncensored battle reports flashed to the folks at home.
What's the hardest part of it?
Not knowing where they are, that's the worst thing.
You lost any friends?
Quite a few. We lost one the other day. The whole thing stink.
It was the first war Americans opposed in huge numbers, openly and passionately. The Vietnam War ended when the communists took Saigon. The end of the war left questions and issues that are still unanswered and unresolved.
Hallelujah! Always!
Ever!
Always!
Ever!
Always!
Ever!
Well, it's time that we recognized ours was in truth a noble cause. Let us tell those who fought in that war that we will never again ask young men to fight and possibly die in a war our government is afraid to let them win.
Vietnam, a noble cause, a shameful venture. This television series looks back on a hard chapter in America's history. 2.5 million Americans fought in Vietnam. And 58,000 Americans died there. Why? Vietnam lasted 15 years, but the Vietnamese have known war a long time, more than 2,000 years. Their traditional enemy was China, their giant neighbor to the north. For centuries, Vietnam was the southernmost part of China's empire. The Vietnamese absorbed Chinese culture and customs, but they never accepted Chinese rule. Today, throughout Vietnam, they commemorate the Trung sisters, who led a rebellion against China in the first century after Christ. The rebellion failed, but the Trung sisters are still heroines, part of a long line of Vietnamese who fought foreign domination.
Our history, from the time of the Hung Kings and the Trung sisters to the era of President Ho Chi Minh, has been a history of great struggle. Throughout history, the Vietnamese people have always done their best to defend the country and to build the nation.
They fought for almost 1,000 years after the Trungs to evict the Chinese. Then they pushed south to their present borders, conquering other peoples in their path. The country expanded so rapidly that it fragmented in a series of civil wars. Despite their internal conflicts, the Vietnamese regarded themselves as one country and one people. But they were too weak and divided to fight off the conquering Europeans in the 19th century. Around 1860, the French seized the area near Saigon. They took over central and northern Vietnam during the next two decades, and by 1885, Vietnam had once again lost its independence. French Indochina at the end of the 1880s. Laos, Cambodia, and Vietnam, which the French divided into three regions, Cochin China, Annam, and Tonkin. To the Vietnamese, the division was a deliberate attempt to destroy their national unity. The Vietnamese resisted. The French called all resistors pirates, and they sent in the troops for the first pacification of Vietnam. They staged public executions. The severed heads were photographed and printed on postcards, which soldiers sent home to sweethearts in Paris with kisses from Hanoi. It took 20 years to get the Vietnamese resistance under control. Then the French could concentrate on the economics of colonialism, trying to transform Vietnam into a source of profit.
The people here suffered a lot because of high taxes and hard forced labor. They worked from dawn till dusk, but they did not have enough to eat.
The cheap labor profited a few French companies, even though Indochina was a financial sinkhole. The French nation spent millions of francs each year to protect and support the colony, while French companies like Michelin Rubber made millions in profits from factories and plantations. There were no major uprisings during these hard years. Vietnamese society was reeling under the impact of westernization. French culture permeated the cities, bringing Western fashions and ideas. The Vietnamese elite began to give their sons a Western education. Almost all of those who would lead the next resistance to the French were French educated. Among them was Ho Chi Minh. Ho Chi Minh's early years are difficult to trace. He was always mysterious about himself, giving few interviews, and preferring in later life to present himself as the benevolent Uncle Ho. Ho was born about 1890 as Nguyen Thach Thanh, the son of an official who resigned rather than serve under the French. As a young man, Ho left his country, working as a ship hand and cook in America, Britain, and France. In 1917, Ho moved to Paris. He took the pseudonym Nguyen Ai Quoc, Nguyen the Patriot, and began to agitate for Vietnam's independence. He tried to plead his cause at the Versailles Conference following World War I, but was not admitted. His effort made him famous among the Vietnamese in France. In 1920, Nguyen Ai Quoc became a founding member of the French Communist Party, the first Vietnamese communist. The communists sent him to Moscow for training in 1923. He traveled widely, organizing expatriate Vietnamese into a revolutionary party. Reports during the next 17 years placed him in Germany, China, Thailand, France, Russia. France was proud of its colonial record.
Dans de nombreuses régions, autrefois désertiques, où des tribus hostiles les unes aux autres traînaient une existence misérable, les civilisateurs français ont apporté la paix, le travail, la prospérité, la joie. Par son importance et sa fécondité, le domaine français d'outre-mer est devenu un élément essentiel de la vie économique mondiale, une force active de la civilisation, un glorieux témoignage de la grandeur de la France.
...1940 brought the end of this grandeur of France. Japan, pursuing its conquest of China, wanted to block the transport of war material through Vietnam. In June 1940, 3 days after France fell to Nazi Germany, Japan demanded the right to land forces in Indochina. Japan's arrival deeply impressed the Vietnamese. Asians like themselves had overthrown the European colonials, for it was clear who was in charge. The Japanese supported several Vietnamese nationalist groups, but other groups were both anti-French and anti-Japanese. The most important was the Viet Minh, founded in 1941 by Nguyen Ai Quoc. He had returned to Vietnam after 30 years with a new name, Ho Chi Minh, meaning he who enlightens.
After the conference to establish the Viet Minh, Uncle Ho sent out a letter calling for the support of the population. And it was this that rallied the entire country around the movement. And when people realized that Ho Chi Minh was actually Nguyen Ai Quoc, their trust in the movement was further established. This was because the name Nguyen Ai Quoc had been widely known in the country. People knew that he was a great patriot.
The Viet Minh organized guerrilla bases, trained cadres, harassed the French and Japanese, and spread propaganda, urging the peasants to resist.
Why did the Viet Minh fight the Japanese while other Asian nationalists collaborated?
I apologize, but this is a very funny question. At that time, the Japanese had already overthrown the French and begun to dominate our country. So, of course, we had to fight the Japanese.
By early 1945, Vietnam was suffering a terrible famine. People blamed the French and Japanese, who were hoarding rice, feeding it to Japanese troops, and even exporting it to Japan, while an estimated 2 million Vietnamese out of 8 million in the northern areas died.
At that time, in our estimate, at least 40,000 starving, poor peasants arrived in Hanoi to beg for food and to wait for handouts, for alms. The French did not organize any hunger relief, and the Japanese specifically forbade us to carry out any hunger relief effort of our own. People dug into the garbage dumps in order to find any edible thing at all. They also ate rats. But this was not enough to keep them alive.
The Viet Minh organized the peasants to seize rice stocks and gained tremendous prestige. This peasant support gave them a political edge they never lost.
It's a long, tough road to Tokyo. It's longer to go to Tokyo than it is to Berlin, in every sense of the word. The defeat of Germany will not mean the end of the war against Japan.
As the war in Europe drew to a close, Allied attention turned to Asia and the war against Japan. One of the pressing needs was intelligence. The Viet Minh believed Allied statements supporting the rights of oppressed peoples. They had given the Allies information about Japanese troop movements, So the Americans turned to the Viet Minh and its leader, Ho Chi Minh.
I first met Ho on the China border between China and Indochina in the last days of April of 1945. He was quite an interesting individual, very sensitive, very gentle, a rather frail type. We spoke quite at length about the general situation, not only in Indochina, but the world at large.
We knew he was a communist, but we also felt, as they did, and the way anybody who has known, met Ho Chi Minh, that I've ever talked with, had the same feeling, he was first a nationalist and second a communist. That is, he was interested in getting the independence of his people, and then he thought probably the best thing for them was the communist type of government. But he was a nationalist first and foremost.
The Viet Minh agreed to help the Allies. Major Patty sent a training group, the Deer Mission, into the northern mountains.
The Deer team went in and they organized out of about 500 Vietnamese. We selected, with the help of General Giap, selected 200. We spent the next 4 weeks training these young men into the art of using automatic weapons, demolition equipment, and the infiltrating and exfiltrating into various dangerous areas. There, for the first time, we saw what kind of troops the Viet Minh were. They were very willing, fine, young nationalists, really what we used to say gung-ho type. They were willing to risk their lives for their cause, the cause of independence against the French.
Before Ho's men could prove their willingness, World War II was over. The sudden Japanese collapse took many in French Indochina by surprise, but the Viet Minh were ready for what they called the August Revolution. Declaring Vietnam independent, they marched in to take Hanoi peacefully. Ho Chi Minh formed a government in Hanoi, carefully mixing in members of other nationalist groups. But in the south, away from Ho's moderating influence, his followers started purging rival nationalists. Still with the Viet Minh, and perhaps reinforcing the idea of American support, was the OSS.
2 or 3 days after I met Ho, he asked me to come in and stop in and see him, at which time he wanted to show me something. And what he wanted to show me was a draft of the Declaration of Independence that he was going to declare several days later. Of course, it was in Vietnamese and I couldn't read it. And when it was interpreted to me, I was quite taken aback to hear the words of the American Declaration of Independence. Words about liberty and life and the pursuit of happiness, etc. I just couldn't believe my own ears.
On September 2nd, 1945, on board the USS Missouri in Tokyo Bay, Japan formally surrendered. And on the same day throughout Vietnam, the Vietnamese celebrated their self-proclaimed Independence Day and the formation of a new country, the Democratic Republic of Vietnam. In Hanoi, Ho Chi Minh read a speech that began, "All men are created equal. They are endowed by their creator with certain inalienable rights."
I can say that the most moving moment was when President Ho Chi Minh climbed the steps and the national anthem was sung. It was the first time that the national anthem of Vietnam was sung in an official ceremony. Uncle Ho then read the Declaration of Independence, which was a short document. As he was reading, Uncle Ho stopped and asked, "Compatriots, can you hear me?" This simple question went into the hearts of everyone there. After a moment of silence, they all shouted, "Yes, we hear you." And I can say that we did not just shout with our mouths, but with all our hearts, the hearts of over 400,000 people standing in the square then.
Yeah.
After Uncle Ho finished reading the Declaration of Independence, an airplane, a small one, circled over us. We did not know whose plane it was. We thought that it was a Vietnamese plane. But when it swooped down over us, we recognized the American flag. The crowd cheered enthusiastically.
Ho appealed to President Harry Truman, but he would probably have accepted anyone's support. Truman did not respond to Ho's letters. He had been in office only 4 months in August 1945 and had not had time to formulate a policy on Indochina.
There was quite a division in the State Department over Indochina. Both the Far Eastern office and the European office were in complete agreement that we wanted a strong France recovered in Europe, from the trauma of Vichy and the defeat in the war. But the European division felt to help get the French back on their feet, we should go along with practically anything that the French wanted.
The Allies had worked out a compromise plan to disarm the Japanese. Above the 16th parallel, the Chinese would take the surrender of Japanese troops. The British would do the same in the south. They arrived in Saigon in early September. The British commander, General Douglas Gracie, was a seasoned colonial officer with limited political experience. His orders were to disarm the Japanese and maintain law and order.
He had absolutely no mandate whatever to start talking about handing over French Indochina to anybody other than the French. He had his strict instructions.
The British rearmed the French and helped them drive the Viet Minh out of Saigon. The Viet Minh fought back, but they had few weapons to use against the French troops. In the south, the French retained control. In the north, Ho's Viet Minh had widespread support, but they also faced a problem, 150,000 nationalist Chinese troops. The Chinese came to disarm the Japanese. They stayed to loot and disrupt, and they threatened to remain indefinitely. Desperate to expel the Chinese, Ho Chi Minh negotiated with the French. In March 1946, they reached an agreement. The French colonial authorities displayed their power as Ho Chi Minh, president of the Democratic Republic of Vietnam, came to confirm the agreement permitting French troops back for a limited period. In return, France recognized the new Vietnamese state, and the Chinese army left. Ho Chi Minh was gambling that the French would not try to seize power and that a long-range agreement could eventually be negotiated.
A truce was concluded. There were to be future negotiations to settle the problems between us and France. Under these conditions, we allowed a certain number of French troops to take the place of the nearly 200,000 troops of Chiang Kai-shek, which were to evacuate our country as soon as possible. So we had some breathing time to consolidate our forces.
The French in Hanoi greeted the arriving troops as conquering heroes. The Vietnamese stayed home. Ho Chi Minh traveled to France to continue the negotiations, but the French cabinet had collapsed. There was no one to negotiate with. Ho had to play tourist until a new coalition was formed. While he waited, the French administration in Saigon, acting on its own, declared the southern part of Vietnam separate from the north. It was a violation of the March Agreement, and Ho wondered if there was any point to further negotiations. "Should I go back home?" he asked. He was told the new government would straighten it out in Paris. In 1946, Ho had been famous as a patriot for a quarter of a century, and the Vietnamese in Paris turned out to welcome this first president of an independent Vietnam. The French greeted the veteran communist formally as a chief of state. At the time in France, communists were part of the government. In public, relations were cordial, but in fact, the French and Vietnamese negotiators were far apart. The negotiations held at the historic Fontainebleau Chateau went badly. The Vietnamese insisted that southern Vietnam was part of their country. The French would not budge.
When the meeting began, the chief of the French delegation, Max André, said to me, "We only need an ordinary police operation for 8 days to clean all of you out." There was no need for negotiations.
The solution had to come from Fontainebleau. Then the negotiations at Fontainebleau failed. From then on, relationships deteriorated. The climate deteriorated.
The March agreement was dead. With French and Viet Minh forces at close range, the fighting escalated. There were provocations on both sides. In November 1946, the French shelled Haiphong. Many French officers believed only force would stop the Viet Minh.
When we visited Haiphong afterwards, all Vietnamese neighborhoods were completely wiped out. There were dead buried under debris. It is difficult to know the exact figure. But the larger part of the city, it seemed to us, from what we saw, almost the entire Vietnamese part of the city had been destroyed.
General Phong tried to reason with General Giap.
"Listen," I said, "I know war, murders, deaths, destruction, bridges blown up, burning houses. This is unthinkable. We have to prevent this." He said to me, "You listen. Politics come before economics. The destruction is not important. The deaths, 1 million Vietnamese deaths, not important. The French will die too. We are ready. It will last 2 years, 5 years if necessary. We will no longer give in."
By late 1946, Ho Chi Minh's government was forced out of Hanoi, out of the cities. The first Vietnam War had started. The French were confident that they could wipe out Giap's ragtag army quickly. They were a modern army with modern weapons, most bought with U.S. aid. The Viet Minh had widespread support from the peasants.
"I heard about Uncle Ho, who fought for the rights of the peasants and the workers. So as a peasant who had suffered a lot, I realized that the only correct thing for me to do was to follow the same path."
"At first, we did not have any weapons except for bamboo spears. But in the northern part of our country, they were producing arms. I was appointed to go there to report on the situation in the south. Uncle Ho told me that he carried the south in the depth of his heart, and I should tell him what we needed so that the central government could supply us to fight the French and drive them out of the country. I replied that we needed guns. Uncle Ho said that the central government could only give us so many guns because they did not have many. The main thing, he said, was to capture the enemy's guns and use these guns against them.
The French bogged down in a quicksand war. Again and again, they declared an area pacified, only to find it slipping back into Viet Minh control. The guerrillas seemed to be everywhere and nowhere. In an attempt to take popular support away from the Viet Minh, the French created a rival Vietnamese government, the State of Vietnam. As its ruler, the French picked Vietnam's former emperor, Bao Dai. But they placed so many limitations on his regime that, to many Vietnamese, it did not seem at all independent. 1950 brought a new source of help to the Viet Minh. Mao Zedong's forces arrived at Vietnam's borders, having taken all of China. They extended diplomatic recognition to Ho's government, the first country to do so. The Soviet Union followed quickly. And a week later, the United States recognized Bao Dai's rival state. Lines were being drawn in a continuing Cold War.
In the early 50s, the United States had a concept of communism, international communism, as a hard, monolithic block of China and Russia with no crevices in it that was seeking to expand and gain a dominant position in the world. In Europe, they had taken over Eastern Europe, pushed into Czechoslovakia, and in Southeast Asia, an area in which we had interest, they seemed to be trying to do the same thing.
The cause of freedom is being challenged throughout the world today by the forces of imperialistic communism.
In May 1950, for the first time, President Truman authorized direct U.S. aid for the French war in Indochina, $10 million, the beginning of an American commitment.
They have proved time after time that their talk about peace is only a cloak for imperialism.
The U.S. commitment deepened after North Korean troops invaded South Korea at the end of June 1950.
It was decided on the very weekend of the North Korean attack that we would step up our aid very significantly to the French and to Southeast Asia, because we did not know at that point whether or not the Chinese might attempt to move into that area as a part of a general offensive in Asia.
By the end of 1950, the United States had given $150 million in aid to the French forces, including planes, tanks, fuel, ammunition, and napalm. As U.S. strategists looked at Asia, they saw a spreading communist menace. The fight in Korea had become an international war. And in Vietnam, the Viet Minh had linked up with communist China. Viet Minh war capacities improved dramatically.
We used the new weapons to mount offensives against the French. We were able to wipe out two large French units and capture all their weapons. The way was cleared for communications between Vietnam and the outside world. Then we received military aid from China, especially equipment.
The defeats on the northern border were a disaster for the French. The Indochina War was no longer just a colonial conflict. It was still small, but it had become international, supported on both sides by major powers. By the end of 1953, America was paying 80% of the war, over $1 billion a year. Le Jaunissement, France's Vietnamizing of the war, and other strategies to gain Vietnamese support had failed. The French controlled the cities, but the Viet Minh controlled the countryside. The French controlled the day, the Viet Minh the night. General Henri de Navarre came in as the fifth French commander in 5 years.
When General Navarre arrived, he opened a file right away, and on that file I wrote war goals. We looked for what to tell the troops. Well, until the end, this file remained practically empty. We never could express concretely our war goals.
General Navarre tried yet another new strategy. French units were set up in remote areas, supplied by air. Their mission was to search out and destroy the Viet Minh. The French planned to test their new strategy in a valley set among the western mountains, 170 miles from Hanoi, Dien Bien Phu. The Viet Minh had passed through the valley during a major attack on Laos. The French expected another attack and thought Dien Bien Phu would be the place to engage them. In November 1953, 12,000 French troops began dropping into the valley under the command of Colonel Christian de Castro. The top French command in Saigon was sure that Giap would never be able to mass enough troops around Dien Bien Phu, never get heavy artillery up the hills, never keep supply lines open. The command at Dien Bien Phu was equally confident. The artillery officer insisted that no Viet Minh gun would be able to fire more than 3 rounds.
I saw all sorts of civilian and military authorities go through Dien Bien Phu. Unless my memory is completely twisted, I don't remember a single one. Absolutely not a single one of these authorities who didn't find that Dien Bien Phu was a formidable base. It was the great land and air base. It was untakeable.
The Viet Minh saw Dien Bien Phu as a great opportunity, but a great gamble too. Ho Chi Minh's forces had lost heavily in attacks on other French strong points, but they decided to take the risk.
From Thay Nguyen, it took us about 45 days. We marched at night and rested during the day. Sometimes, we just slept on the roadsides if there were no shelters around.
The French command was inviting a battle because they thought the Viet Minh would never be able to get enough troops and guns to Dien Bien Phu. But they did. 51,000 Viet Minh soldiers, four times the number of French troops, crossed the mountains carrying supplies on their backs and bicycles and hauling guns. Both sides had a special reason for wanting to win at Dien Bien Phu. At this same time, January 1954, the great powers were meeting in Berlin. They set a date and place, April 26th in Geneva, to meet and discuss Asian issues, including the Indochina crisis. On March 13th, Giap launched his attack on Dien Bien Phu. The battle began with massive human wave assaults. The Viet Minh guns blanketed French artillery from positions so well dug in and camouflaged that the French planes could not get at them. The first post fell within 8 hours. By the next day, March 14th, the Viet Minh shelling had destroyed the main airstrip. The French command staff was shocked. Colonel de Castres became withdrawn, uncommunicative. On the second night, the artillery commander committed suicide, saying, "I am completely dishonored." 4 days into the battle, the Viet Minh controlled the entire perimeter. The cost was high, thousands dead and wounded among the Viet Minh. Giap decided to change strategy.
This decision on the Dien Bien Phu front constitutes for me one of the biggest and the most difficult decisions in my fighting life.
As commander, General Vo Nguyen Giap decided to end this attack based on the human wave tactic. The entire plan was changed. The attack was stopped, and all the heavy artillery pieces were pulled back to a distance. Then trenches and tunnels were dug, and the morale of the troops was rebuilt based on the slogan, "Advance solidly, fight solidly." Shovels became extremely important weapons. All the cadres and soldiers put most of their time and energy into digging trenches and tunnels. We slowly surrounded Dien Bien Phu with trenches, cutting into the airstrip so it could not be used again, slowly tightening the noose around the necks of the French.
With the airstrip out, the French garrison was dependent on parachute drops, but Viet Minh anti-aircraft fire forced pilots to fly too high. Supplies began falling into enemy hands. General Giap's change in strategy was working, and he settled in for a long siege. For the French, Dien Bien Phu became a nightmare. The rainy season started early with drenching downpours. French dugouts and shelters collapsed. Clean water became impossible to find. Medical supplies ran out. No planes could land to evacuate the wounded. Men who were wounded in the trenches sunk under the yard-high mud to die.
I arrived during the night of May 2nd, and Dien Bien Phu fell on May 7th. The memory I keep of it is one block of time. There was no day or night. I never lay down, I never slept. I don't remember eating. At 4 in the morning, there was a lull. We were 35 left at my post with one machine gun, one grenade left. So I asked on the radio, I said, "Since you cannot send reinforcements," he said, "Where do you want me to get them? You know there's nothing left." "Then give me authorization to get out." He answered very simply, saying, "No way. You're paratroopers. You're there to die." We built a barricade with corpses at the entrance, since we had no sandbags, and we waited. And we saw the shadows coming one by one, the Viet Minh. I decided to throw my grenade, and we immediately got return fire. One of my last impressions was to feel the wall of corpses shivering under the burst of fire. Then a grenade must have hit my helmet, because the net was burned and the helmet dented. American helmets are very solid. I lost consciousness, and when I came to, there was above me, very close, a surgeon's mask from which a voice came, "You are a prisoner of the Army of the Democratic Republic of Vietnam."
Though Viet Minh combat cameramen were present at Dien Bien Phu, scenes of the 55-day battle were restaged by a Soviet director after the French defeat. Some of the film sequences are authentic, some reenacted. Dien